Welcome, everyone. I woke up this morning, looked out of the window by chance. I just saw raining. Few flakes of snow falling down. So I look at the weather. They said it's the coldest day so far in April. Perfect, let's get our patients. Well, just to make the plot worse, we decided to go at that 7 o'clock, where all our Parkinson's patients are tired and exhausted. Fantastic. Well, when it comes to Parkinson's, no jokes about this. My name is Dr. Ashok Sriram. I'm a movement neurologist by training. I got a 2-year fellowship at the University of Florida. We started our program here, Movement Disorders, at Spectrum Health about 2 years ago, well, less than 2 years ago. Coming June, it'll be 2 years. We set up a program, and we have a team of movement disorder health professionals working with us. Tonight, you're going to be hearing from, of course, I'll be talking about a multidisciplinary care plan for our Parkinson's patients. We also have three other speakers with us. Dr. Kobet, you want to raise your hands? And he's our movement disorders neurologist. He'll be talking about introductions of Parkinson's disease, basic treatments. And we have Dr. Dave Bertram. He's our clinical neuropsychologist. And we have Dr. Hayden Boyce. He's our movement disorder neurosurgeon who will be talking about deep brain stimulation and other surgical treatments options available. Few housekeeping things. So we do have a little piece of paper with pen and, on your table. So two options available. If you have any questions, we're going to have the talks first. Each of our speakers will get about 15 minutes. So we're going to wrap it up in about an hour. And after that, we got a half hour session for questions and answers. So two ways you can, you know, you can just raise your hand and you get the microphone. You can ask a question face to face, or if you rather prefer to write it down, please jot it down on a piece of paper, and someone is going to pick up from each of those tables. And we'll go one after the other, and we'll go from there. So I think that's all I have. Is there anything else to go for? All right, very good. Our first speaker today is Dr. Kobet. I'm going to invite him up to the stage. He'll be talking about introductions to the Parkinson's disease.
Just want to make sure this works here. There we go. All right. So I'm Dr. Kobet. It's great to see such a huge turnout tonight. They asked me to talk a bit about the diagnosis and initial treatment planning of Parkinson's disease, but also, I'm grateful to be one of the newest members of the interdisciplinary Parkinson's team here. I have no disclosures. All right. So, since I'm going first, I should also address this question of briefly about the complicated question of what is Parkinson's disease. Let's see. Parkinson's disease is a disease of the, it's a progressive disease of the nervous system. It's one of the neurodegenerative conditions. It was named after James Parkinson, the English physician who actually initially described it in 1817. There's about 7.5 million people worldwide with Parkinson's. That's the most recent figure I could find. This is actually much higher than people estimated in a study back in 2004. And the reason this number is exploding is one of the biggest risk factors for Parkinson's is age, increasing age, and people are living longer. So by 2030, they estimate 9 or 10 million people worldwide. The typical onset age is about 60, but this is variable. You know, there's actually 10% of people with Parkinson's are younger than 40. So, you know, you get people older diagnosed, you get people much younger diagnosed. But there's also a common question of, does this run in families? Is this inherited? Not usually, it's usually not typically thought of as something that runs in families, but there are maybe 10 to 15% of cases that actually do, and there's a lot of interesting research into the genetics of Parkinson's as well, which is another huge topic, but we're not going to get into that tonight. So Parkinson's disease, I'm not going to get too much into the basic science, but just the clinically relevant stuff here. It's primarily affects an area of the brain called the basal ganglia, which is an important area that helps regulate movement, coordinated movements, balance. But over time, Parkinson's begins to involve other areas of the brain, like the cerebral, the cortex of the brain and the autonomic nervous system. This is part of the reason why you get a lot more than just those classic motor symptoms that people associate with Parkinson's disease. And we'll come back to that. People with Parkinson's disease become deficient in a substance called dopamine. Dopamine is a chemical neurotransmitter. It helps the brain cells in the basal ganglia relay messages that are helpful, that are needed for smooth coordinated movements. So as Parkinson's progresses, the cells that make this dopamine start to degenerate. You can actually see over time, you know, these pigmented cells making the dopamine, then they start to go away. You're losing cells here. You're not making enough dopamine. But when you reach a certain threshold, and they think maybe 60 to 80% of those cells, that's when those classic motor symptoms start to become apparent on examination. And you start to see the signs. But it's interesting to note that the process has begun a long time before you actually see those symptoms. So when the tremor starts, that Parkinson's has been going on for years before then. And some scientists are looking into ways to pre-screen people before those signs develop. And they're looking at things like the interesting phenomenon that people have, like losing their sense of smell a long, long before they ever develop a tremor, their balance issues, or the sleep disorders. There's one called the REM, or rapid eye movement behavior disorder, where people actually start to act out their dreams. This can occur many, many years before the other classic motor symptoms begin. So there's these four basic motor symptoms that we all kind of mostly associate with Parkinson's disease. Tremor is the biggest one that people think of when they think of Parkinson's quite often, because you can see it, and it's very obvious sometimes. The classic example is a resting tremor. And even at one point, Parkinson's was called the shaking palsy. But it's interesting to note that a lot of people don't realize that maybe up to 30% of patients with Parkinson's don't even have any tremor. Bradykinesia, this is a fancy word for slowing of movement or incompleteness of movement. When I examine a patient to look for this, I have them, you know, for example, do finger tapping or movements like this, and I watch. You have to make them keep doing it, and either the movements will become smaller and slower. They can't maintain those big, fast movements. So it's interesting also, one of the mysteries of Parkinson's disease is that for some reason it's classically, or typically it's asymmetric, so the tremor and the bradykinesia and the rigidity will be more on one side, and over time gradually start to involve the other side of the body. And then rigidity, of course. The classic example is the cogwheel rigidity that you can. It's caused by the combination of tremor and rigidity. So when I move a patient's arm around, I can feel feel like there's almost two gears running and meshed in opposite directions. And that's a classic sign. And then postural instability. Patients develop different degrees of balance issues, some much more than others, but one way you look for this in clinic is you have them stand in front of you and you pull their shoulders back to see how many steps they take back, or On occasion, you actually have to catch the patient because they might fall backwards at times. My mentor once taught me that you usually want to have your back to the wall, especially if your patient is larger than you, because you actually do have to catch people from time to time. So two important things I wanted to point out at this point is that everybody's Parkinson's disease progresses differently. Almost sometimes it's like it's a different disease in different people. One person might have primarily tremor as their issue, as their complaint, and another person, they'll have no tremor, but they have mostly just rigidity and balance issues. So it's almost like it's a different disease, and some people even advocate that you call it a Parkinson's syndrome rather than Parkinson's disease. And that's part of why you get this frustrating issue of not being able to predict, what things are going to be like years down the line and how different people's disease will progress. It is generally, though, a slowly progressive disorder, so the symptoms will gradually worsen over time. You're never able to exactly know exactly how fast in different people. So there's some other not as obvious symptoms that are more subtle and difficult to pick up on sometimes, especially in the early stages of Parkinson's and in younger patients. Some of the more subtle things are going to be shoulder pain, or somebody will say, "Yeah, my wife is telling me that I'm not swinging my arm as much on one side," or the voice gets softer. We call it hypophonia. So patients will, more often the spouse will complain of this, and the patient thinks that the person with Parkinson's thinks they're talking at a normal volume, but people just can't seem to hear him well enough. Well, stooped posture is in about 60% of patients, but not always. And then the micrography, as you see an example here, the handwriting tends to get smaller over time in some people. And we have, I'm not going to go through each and every one of these, but this is the long list of the non-motor symptoms, probably not even the full list here, but just to give you an idea that there's a lot more symptoms than just those classic motor symptoms. And for a long time, people have kind of overlooked these a bit, and there's been a movement to try to get clinicians and get the physician to ask more about these symptoms, because a lot of times patients don't even realize that the things like the mood issues, the orthostatic hypotension. So when the patient stands up, they get dizzy, constipation. A lot of people people don't even realize this is part of Parkinson's as well. So the patient doesn't bring it up, and if the clinician doesn't ask. All right. So just briefly about the treatment plan. As you know, there's currently no cure for Parkinson's disease. This is not for lack of trying. There's many brilliant minds working on this. But for now, the treatment is focused on helping the patient control the symptoms they're dealing with and improve quality of life. There's a long list. There's over a dozen medicines that we use for Parkinson's. Most of these are what they call dopaminergic, meaning they're either aimed at temporary replenishing the dopamine that the brain is not making enough of, which is why he was explaining that earlier, or mimicking the action of dopamine. So classically what I'll do also as a diagnostic technique is to try a patient on something like levodopa, which is meant to replace the dopamine that the brain is not making enough of. One of the rewarding things about treating Parkinson's is sometimes, not infrequently, actually, you'll get patients very surprised. They come back after being started on these medicines, and they notice quite often an immediate benefit. Not always, but that is one of the things that makes treating Parkinson's one of the more rewarding specialties. So, the dopaminergic medicines help, with different things like the tremor, the rigidity, the smoothness of movement. These are all things that could potentially benefit. But it's not all about the medications. usually very early on, I start to talk about exercise. For one big example, try to get a sense of how much the person is exercising, and then explaining, you know, the importance of it, and physical therapy as well. There is a growing body of research looking into the benefits of exercise, and there's an immediate benefit and there's a long-term benefit. It's one of the things that actually can potentially slow down the disease process. So that's something I usually talk about, you know, very early on when this is looking like Parkinson's or probable Parkinson's. And if somebody is not exercising at all, you know, I try to just get them slowly doing a little bit more. But if somebody's, you know, on the exercise bike a couple times a week, it's one of the important things about the exercise is that that they've learned is that kind of pushing yourself is one of the more important, a little bit out of your comfort zone is one of the most important things about getting to get that benefit out of exercise. And then one of the other things important when we're talking about treatment is having what they call an interdisciplinary care team. Okay, that means having your primary care doctor and your neurologist and your physical therapist, speech therapist. These are just potentials, like potentially even a neurosurgeon, and a psychiatrist, neuropsychologist. These are all potential people that are involved in this interdisciplinary care team, and they need to be having a good level of communication. So with that note, I'm going to hand over the mic to my colleague, Dr. Sriram.
Going to have no disclosures. Well, I'm going to be this is what I'm going to be talking about. We'll talk about a different kind of a treatment model. Most of the big centers, they've already adopted it, and we are there, almost there, to give a model called as a multidisciplinary care model. Now, I'll be also talking about the newest updates. January and February was exciting. There are two drugs that are FDA approved. We'll be talking about them. And what is a multidisciplinary care? So it involves a group of highly trained professionals. You know, they're working together to make a treatment plan, to make how to take care of a specific person, trying to make personalized plans, assessments. The goals of all this multidisciplinary team is to give a kind of a sort of a holistic approach, not just treat one symptom, not just treat, you know, the one non-motor symptom. We just have to see the person as a whole, and we make plans based on that. Why do we have to do this personalized plans? We always know that. We always go to your support group. You see that someone has got a tremor, someone doesn't have a tremor. In fact, I still have to see two people with Parkinson disease that look exactly the same way. I'll put it another way. No two people experience Parkinson's in exactly the same way as well. You know, they're all different presentations. When you talk about treatment, we just have to look at them. Always another common question I get is, what is a good exercise program for me? There's no answer for that. The answer is that we just have to look at you to see what kind of symptoms do you have. That's where this personalized care plan comes in. We got to customize. We have to look at the patient, and we got to make calls based on that. And as the slides are saying, that you are unique and your treatment needs are unique as well. So this is where a team of professionals trying to assess what the needs are in terms of medical treatment, in terms of exercise plans, and in terms of what surgical treatments also. And I just want to put this slide to give an idea about, you know, the many phases, how Parkinson's presents. Primarily, we talk about a tremor-dominant Parkinson's disease where the tremor is a predominant symptom. And we see some people who are stiff and rigid. We call it as an akinetic rigid type of Parkinsonism. They don't have tremors at all. These are the ones that are a little difficult to treat, diagnose at the beginning. Tremor is the easiest one. If you see a tremor, he's going to get diagnosed very early on in the course of the disease, as opposed to someone who is stiff and rigid and doesn't have a tremor. Again, there is another variant of Parkinson's called as postural instability variety, where they have more trouble with walking and balance. And look at that. These are, we call it as a premotor symptoms. These come on, as Dr. Kobet was mentioning about, these symptoms come on even before you have your first motor symptom. Some of them are constipation, acting out dreams, loss of smell, and sleep impairments. Those are some of the cardinal Parkinson's disease symptoms. And we have also some additional stoop posturing imbalances and freezing gait. So to diagnose for Parkinson's, we need, look at that first symptom right there. We need a 2 out of 3 criteria for that to diagnose a Parkinson's disease. And we have all of their symptoms of trouble swallowing, you know, slurring of speech, spasms, we call it as dystonia. Bent spine, we call it as, these are some of the rare presentations called as camptochromia. Again, there are motor symptoms and there are non-motor symptoms. The non-motor symptoms are something that's not related to movements. They're something a little different. They are not related to your typical tremors. They're as common as a tremor, you know, anxiety, depression, mania, impulsive behaviors, cognitive impairments, dementia, urinary incontinence. These are all. Look at that. How many faces does it have? My point is that seeing just a neurology probably is not sufficient at this point. You know, this is where we push to have a multidisciplinary team approach. Just for example, this is a study that came in, this via National Parkinson's Foundation, and it came back in, the results were published in 2014. It says that mood, anxiety, and depression taken together, all three together, have the greatest impact on quality of life, even greater than the common motor symptoms seen in Parkinson's disease. This is very important. You go to your neurologist, if he does not address his non-motor symptoms of anxiety, constipation, or sleep issues, well, we did not address half of it at all. So these takes equal importance when you treat them. And we look at this, the second most common influential factor is actually impaired mobility. So it's important to treat motor symptoms. It's equally important to treat non-motor symptoms as well. This is three things. You know, even my, where we're trained, my mentor keep telling you, if you want to keep your patients happy, three things you need to address. Address constipation, address sleep issues, and address mood issues. Find out if they have anxiety or depression going on. If you don't take care of these three things, the quality of life is not going to be any better. If the tremor might be better, but if you don't address these three problems, the overall, when you look at it, the quality of life is not better either. So this is where we want to introduce. There's so many things to take care of. That's why we have this, a team approach. This is where a neurologist, we have a physical therapist, an occupational therapist, speech therapy involvement, social worker. And these are all, each one of the departments has got a specific role. You know, let me mention about who's always has it. What's the difference between a neurologist and a movement disorder neurologist? There's a difference between the two. A movement disorder neurologist, someone who's got special training, once he's done with residency, he spent time from anywhere from 1 to 2 years doing a fellowship, just looking at Parkinson's disease. So there is a difference. So when you go see your primary doctor and neurologist, you have to ask this question, is there something else that can be offered at this time? And once a year, you have to make a visit to see a movement neurologist to get what is latest, what else is available in terms of treatment options. And as I said, you know, when you look at physical therapy, they are addressing specific things, you know, balance issues and walking difficulties. In fact, I've got to put it straight in front of you guys, like Parkinson's by itself never kills anyone. But two things we worry about is the falls. That's a game changer. When a patient falls, everything changes after that point. They never go back to home. Hospitalizations, that's the number one cause of mortality or the death in Parkinson's patients is falls. Why wait until someone falls? We just have to preemptively strike it. It's what we call it preventive medicine. Pick up things before it does happen. This is where a team approach is important. And again, occupational therapies. We want to keep you independent as long as possible. You know, as you get older, our dependency keeps on increasing. With Parkinson's disease, it doesn't make it any easier. And when you ask what is the most scary part of the whole experience about Parkinson's, they tell that I'm losing my being independent. That's the most bothersome for most patients. Occupational therapy addressing this, working on your hand dexterities, improving your movements to get that, to keep you as long independent as possible. And speech therapy, of course, the second most common cause why people get into trouble, we call it as in mortalities, or because of swallow troubles. One wrong and a food going into the wrong pipe, we call it as aspiration. It sets up aspiration pneumonias, and life is never the same. These are the two most common things, falls and aspirations. And again, we gotta be actively looking at it, pick up before these things happen. If the aspiration happens, hospitalization happens, it's too late. We just have to prevent, we just have to practice this preventive medicine there too. Okay, and social worker, biggest role. You know, we see you guys in the clinics and we address only medical issues. And there's a lot of things that goes beyond, you know. We don't know about how your family dynamics are. We don't know about your financial status. We don't know, we don't even give you what kind of resources are available in the community out there. That's where the role is, the social worker giving you the resources that are available in the community. And of course, the most important part is a caregiver's burden. That's an important thing. I mean, it's, I always tell before, like if there's a book about a Parkinson's patient, the main hero is actually the caregiver. He's the one who sees all walks of all stages of the disease and things like that. We applaud them as well. But a caregiver's burden is the most important thing we need to address too, along with taking care of our Parkinson's patient. Social worker typically does that. When you look at it, who is in the middle of all of this? That's our patient. This is where the model of our patient-centered care came on. This is where we want to make sure that, you know, you are the reason we are here. I just want to make it more clear that this is where we want to do. If you're not in the clinic, this is what we want to be doing, coming out and giving us talks about, you know, what latest available, to dispel the information. And April happens to be Parkinson's Awareness Month. What a great time to bring everybody in to get update about what's new in Parkinson's and what's going on in terms of research and things like that. My point about finishing this slide is that this is where we want to have this, all this multidisciplinary teams, go back in the slide. We want to happen all in the same visit. That's what our plan is going to be. This is where we're moving ahead to have these teams. When you come to the clinic, you want to be seen by a neurologist. You want to be seen by your physical therapist, occupational and speech, not that they're doing therapy, but they're doing evaluations. They're trying to evaluate to see, do you really need physical therapy at this point? Do you need speech therapy at this point? Are we have to worry about swallows? Are you worried about some modifications we got to do at home? This is where our clinics are all set up. You see that, and that's why we say, you see, first you stay in the same room. The neurologist sees you, he moves on. The physical therapy, the therapy people come in the same room, the sees on, move on. Ultimately, you're gonna see the social worker coming in and giving us little tips about resources and things like that. We want to see this all happen in the same visit. And we want to make, at the end of the visit, we want to make a treatment plan based on just looking at you. We want to customize care. That's why this is where our multidisciplinary team is coming along. We gather valuable information and we keep our communications very open. We sit down, we discuss about the plan, about what to do and how to take care. We're not about looking at making a plan about tomorrow. We want to make a plan for 5 years, maybe 10 years. From now, how to do it, and we're gonna make it right now. And we're gonna practice, as I said, preventive care. Pick up things before things do actually happen. When things happen, it's too late. Okay, we already have this kind of a team approach going on for our DBS patients. That's what we started off. It's almost like a pilot program for us. We already incorporated most of these services when we see our DBS patients right from the evaluations. They go through this process. It's a two-day process where they come in. They have neurologists. They have all these people come in. We also, three services that are behind the scenes that may not happen on the same day. These are psychiatry, neuropsychology, and neurosurgery. The psychiatry looking at psychiatric issues, depression, looking at mania. Some of the medication side effects is mania and psychosis, visual hallucinations, what the medications can do, make sure that they're all taken care of. Neuropsychology, of course, Dr. Bertram will be talking about cognitive impairments, dementias that happens, Parkinson's disease dementia that goes along. It's part of the disease. And of course, neurosurgery, you know, when the medication doesn't go, we just have to look at other options. We have deep brain stimulation, great option for us, and the Dr. Boyce is going to be talking about deep brain stimulation and what other options do we have in terms of surgical treatment options. Just to finish off this slide, you know, we're moving along, but by July, August, we have another movement disorder person joining our team. That's going to be three movement disorder neurologists. 2 years ago, it was zero. There's not a person who is fellowship trained movement disorder person in Grand Rapids. Now there are three people just in Spectrum Health, not to mention about St. Mary's. They have two other fellowship people. So a lot of professionals are coming in this way. This is a Parkinson's hotspot. We got Van Andelen's here there. And we do have a Udall Center right there in the downtown. This is a great place for a treatment. In the future, the way, the direction, the research is going on, probably my guess is in the 5 years, this is going to be the main treatment hub for patients for Parkinson's, one-stop shopping for our Parkinson's patients, as they call it. I'm going to quickly talk about what the newest are. I'm going to talk about a medication called Rytary. We'll talk about Duopa pump. Most of the patients have been asking about this. What is this Duopa pump? How does it help? Am I a candidate? This is a good time to talk about it. And I'm going to a little briefly mention about the early STEM DBS study. All right, what is Rytary? It's an FDA-approved medication, released more recently, January of 2015. And I put in, it comes in about four? That's right there. So it comes in like four different formulations and four different doses that comes in there. We're also very new. I'm also learning about this. We started on a few of our patients at small doses. What is Rytary and how is it different from the traditional medications that you've been taking on? This is, again, a combination of carbidopa, levodopa. This is the same medication. We call it, as a common name is Sinemet. But even though the drug, even though the chemicals are same, the drug delivery system is a little different. What they have is that they have the little beads in there, the little spirals in there, and there are two different types in there. One is an immediate release one, another one is an extended release one. It's in a combination of it. Always we have a trouble with regular Sinemet. It doesn't last too long. And there is this Sinemet CR medication available. Well, it doesn't kick in too fast. So it's a solution. As I said, we are still looking at, you know, how effective it is actually in the, when we actually do it in the clinics. But in theory, it looks like it's a combination of immediate release and a long-acting or an extended release medication so that it kicks in right away and the blood levels keeps on going for about 5 to 6 hours. That's pretty good. Supposed to be taken three times a day. And I think it's a fantastic medication. Some of our advanced Parkinson's patient takes every 2 hours, 2.5 pills every 2 hours, every 2.5, 3 hours. So when you look at that, it looks like it's a pretty good option in there. But, you know, there should be a way to fix our criteria. Who is a candidate for these medications? Like, as I mentioned about, why do we have to switch to Rytary? And it's taking like, you know, it's taking too long. And you know, some patients complain about it. It's taking an hour. It's taking it for an hour and a half to kick in. That's one of those options to switch to. Medication wearing off. We know that there's ups and downs, on and off effects. It's very common in Parkinson's. You take the pill, you see the benefit. And as soon as you get close to your next dose of medication, half hour, 45 minutes, 1 hour before your next dose, you see the medication wear off. There's ups and downs. That's one of the solutions for that. You have that ups and downs, talk to your doctor, see if it's a good switch for the medication to keep that constant, smoothly, no ups and downs. We don't want ups and downs. And sometimes there is something called as a severe on and off fluctuations where you feel like you take the pill, work down right there, and suddenly they go off as if like someone has turned off the switch at all. These are called severe on off fluctuations. They happen like that. And advanced Parkinson's patients, if they ask them, they'll tell you. Looks like they suddenly, one moment they're talking with you and tell you that was working great, and the next moment, I think I'm off. Looks like they're walking, you got trouble, tremor is coming back, difficulty balance and everything like that. That may be a good option to consider at the time. Again, another, it says when you go, Parkinson's is progressive. Your disease will get, symptoms will get progressively worse. Your requirement for the medication go up and up. Until you hit a point, you start to see a little swaying, call it as dyskinesias. We call it as dyskinesias, and our people start to shake. They're not tremors, they are dyskinesias. They're abnormal involuntary movements. And they get bothersome at some point. And when it happens, dyskinesias, that's another time to switch to Rattari. Again, wasn't mentioned about, it's an old medication, it's nothing new about it, but except that the delivery system is a little different. And we started using on our patients already. So does this change the course of the disease? Does it have any neuroprotection benefit, just like Sinemet? No, it doesn't. It doesn't have a, it doesn't change the course of the disease. Does it cure? No, it doesn't. We don't have a cure yet for Parkinson's. And the other treatment option that was available is called as a duopa pump. It's been there, and we know about this for a long time. A couple of years now. It's been in Europe for about close to 7 or 8 years there already. We're too slow to get this treatment up in here. The FDA is too tight up in here, US, to approve anything at this period. So what is duopa pump? It is a continuous dopamine infusion technology. That's what it is. The theme is a continuous infusion of the medication, the worst we do. You know, most of the problems when you look at Parkinson's, what we are trying to do is we're trying to troubleshoot the complications because of the therapies. We already talked about on and off fluctuations, up and downs with the medication. And the second problem is the dyskinesias. We see that people are swaying when we put on these medications. And the, as I mentioned about the on-off, sudden-offs, and also dyskinesias, to solve, we think that the main problem is the pulsatile nature we take the medications. Taking that every 3 hours or 4 hours, that's the one that's causing the problem. That's what the research tells us. So this is a way to bypass that. Instead of taking the drug pulsatile, why don't we just give it a continuous infusion? That's what the duopa pump technology is. That's how it looks like. It's look a little dangerous to look at it, the picture. But let me go over that, how it is. So basically, this is what we call as, this is a regular PEG tube. You know, it's like a feeding tube. You might have heard about that. It is a regular feeding tube that comes on. And it comes out of the, it goes through the stomach, goes up through here, through the skin, goes into that. And it's actually with this, some little connectors there, the tubing in there goes up to your pump. And this is a pump right here. And this can be changed, the dosages can be changed. And this is a little cartridge that you gotta change it almost once every day. So the basic plot is that this is like a pump that kind of give you the medication continuously goes on. And it's supposed to meant to be done for about 16 hours. You start in the morning, give it a loading dose, and after that it drips continuously, keeps on going slowly. That keeps the blood level steady in there. And we think that keeping that blood level just steady with this medication, that helps with this ups and downs, helps with this swaying going on off fluctuations, everything at all. So it's a very powerful treatment. I would say it's to be comparable to, when you compare it to DBS, it's as powerful as that when you look at it in a certain way. But it's got its own hiccups, and you know, not everyone is a candidate for these things too. These are all some of the other pictures. The main reason I put this slide is that this is how your patients are going to wear this pump around the neck, just like an insulin pump. If you look at it, almost looks like almost the same size. In fact, the pump is almost the same. Again, who are candidates for this? Patients who's having on-off fluctuations. We talked about off time. This is very important. I mean, with Sinemet, we noticed that people take it. It takes about half hour, 45 minutes for it to kick in. And it weighs off, like, say, 1 hour, half hour. So when you add up, there are about 2 hours of off time where they feel like the medication is not there in the body at all. And you take that four times a day, you multiply that with four, you got about 8 hours. So during the 16-hour period during the daytime, you're off for about 8 hours. That's not the quality of life that we want to be. And Parkinson's is all about quality of life. When you wake up in the morning, you got to ask a simple question: do I feel good about myself? If you have these complications, it's going to impair the quality of life that you're going to have. Again, and some of the things that are involved with the pump, it requires a continuous maintenance and requires programming. As I said, there are some hiccups involved with that. I'm not going to go too much detail into that. Just discuss with your doctor to see if you're a candidate for one of these pumps. This requires the tubes require constant monitoring for infections and inflammations. That requires a lot of care. One of the criteria for to get a pump is that we look at their social structure. How supportive is the partner? Is their caregiver is active or not? Are they healthy? You know, it's one of the, they put in a criteria that if you live by yourself and you have this pump, probably more likely you're not gonna get a pump like this. They put it as a mandatory, one of those criteria is there. And as I said, they are powerful symptomatic treatments. And again, it doesn't change the course of the disease, nor it offers cure for the disease. Again, there are some things that we have trouble with. For example, the common question, no, my symptoms don't respond to the medication. I take Sinemet, I take about 2.5 pills a dose, but I still, my tremor doesn't go away. Is that dual pump a solution for them? No, that's not an answer. It only works in people whose Sinemet prior is working for them. So any symptom that's resistant to levodopa, it's not gonna respond to this pump as well. The DBS is another ball game. There are some symptoms with DBS that respond where the levodopa does, for example, a medication resistant tremor. DBS does a wonderful job controlling tremor. So I'm giving a little comparison there. There's not a real head-to-head comparison available between DBS and dual pump. You know, there, we just have to evaluate, take a look at our patients, and we have to customize our care to see who is good and who can get this and who cannot. Again, we talked about that. They're not a cure or a progress delays. I'm gonna briefly mention about it. I'm sure like Dr. Boyce is gonna mention about the early DBS study. This is exciting. This is the kind of a, from a clinician, these are the ones that actually makes us feel good about like the treatment options that are. This is an early STEM study. What the basic plot is that, why don't we wait too long? I know that the DBS window is that short. You don't wanna be too early, you don't wanna be too late, and you want that window. So why do we wait until that it's too late into the complications? Why don't we start implanting these DBS devices when they have the first sign of this complication or an advanced disease? When we call it disease advances and we have this ups and downs going on, dyskinesias, when you see some of those, we think from a clinical standpoint, that's an advanced Parkinson's disease. So that's a European study that came in, and the criteria for that is, again, I mentioned about the motor fluctuations on and off on dyskinesias that divide the patients into two groups. One is a DBS group. Another one is, you know, the best medical treatment that's, that can give for the patient. And we looked at quality of life. We compared with these two groups. We noticed that people who got DBS, they are 26% better in terms of the quality of life when they implant them early on. Don't wait until too late. That's an European study that came in. Again, the Vanderbilt University is actually coming up. They released the pilot data, and it looks very promising, but they are doing a bigger trial to see like if it's really beneficial or not. Their plot is a little different. And why do we even wait until the on and off fluctuations or dyskinesias even develop? Go preemptively. 2 years into disease, just go ahead and do the DBS. See how the quality of life is. The pilot study came back. It's very promising. When you look at the economics, we look at the money, how much it's gonna cost to get the DBS or get it later on, the medications, when you add it up, looks like the DBS looks like a winner at this point. We don't have the big data yet, but we're hopeful. But the pilot data is actually very, very encouraging to go in that direction. I said Dr. Boyce, who's gonna be our neurosurgeon, who's gonna be talking about a little bit more about the early STEM studies. And with that, I'm just gonna turn over the mic to Dr. Bertram. He's our neuropsychologist. We'll be talking about cognitive impairments, dementias, and Parkinson's disease.
The last time I gave a presentation in this room, I actually tripped coming up to the stairs, so we're already off to a better start. If anyone needs to stretch or stand up at any point in time, please feel free. This is a pretty judgment-free zone, and I know you've been sitting for a while. So my name is David Bertram, and I am a neuropsychologist here with Spectrum, and fortunate enough to be a part of the movement disorders team. If you talk to anybody who has met with me clinically, they say, oh, that's the guy I had to spend 5 hours with. What I'm gonna talk about today is related to primarily mental health issues in Parkinson's disease. That will include some of the cognitive issues that arise, but I'm going to paint with some pretty broad strokes here as we discuss some different mental health issues. I don't have any disclosures, but I do want to make it very clear that this is not a comprehensive overview of psychiatric or mental health issues in Parkinson's disease. We don't have enough time to cover that. I'll hit some general topics, okay, and if there are any questions that you have in the Q&A at the end or even after the presentation is over, please don't hesitate to pull me aside, okay? First, I'll talk about some general mental health issues in Parkinson's disease. I can be louder. I can be much louder. I think I'm a little taller than Dr. Sriram. I'm going to really try to drive home the point that Parkinson's disease is not just a movement disorder, and I think Dr. Kobet and Dr. Sriram have already hit on that. I'll go through some treatment considerations, and then we'll wrap it up with some conclusions. We know it is widely researched and well proven that in Parkinson's disease we see increased rates of mental health issues. Just to name a few, depression, anxiety, cognitive concerns, we can see sleep problems, and we can see this interesting thing called apathy, which I'll discuss in a little more detail. This is not comprehensive. These are just some of the more common concerns that people voice. Not everyone experiences all of these things, and not everyone with Parkinson's disease necessarily experiences any of these things. Okay. But what we really want to try to communicate, and what they've done a nice job so far of saying, is that we're looking at the whole person, and the whole person with Parkinson's disease is more than just what we see on the outside. It's been well proven that individuals with Parkinson's disease experience increased rates of depression. Depression can take many different forms. It's not always just sadness. Sometimes there's fatigue. Sometimes we have feelings of worthlessness. Sometimes we see irritability, appetite changes. All of these different things and many other things can represent depression. They can all be symptoms of depression. The reported rates of depression really do vary in Parkinson's disease, depending on the study and depending on what measures they use to assess for depression. But as a general rule, if we see the motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease progress, and as we see the disease progress, we tend to see increased rates of various depressive symptoms. Anxiety. That's also something that a lot of Parkinson's disease individuals talk about. A lot of my patients will talk about the spotlight effect. It feels like everybody's watching me. It's so much worse in public, and I just always feel so anxious. And if you think about it, if you're sitting in a restaurant and you're trying to cut your steak and your knife is bouncing off of your plate, people probably are looking at you. I mean, realistically. And so some of it is real. I mean, they actually are looking at you. And as the symptoms continue to progress, if individuals develop trouble with balance or trouble with walking, what happens when you have trouble with balance and trouble with walking? What kind of risks do you have? Falling, right? If you were walking around concerned about your balance and your gait and falling, yeah, that's going to drive up the anxiety too. Or if you're walking up onto a stage and you trip. We can see a lot of cognitive changes in Parkinson's disease. And some of the more recent research is saying that as many as about 75% to 80% of people who have Parkinson's disease will go on to experience some pretty severe changes to their cognition. Early on in Parkinson's disease, we often see things like bradypnea, which is slowed thinking speed. We can see difficulty with memory. Maybe things aren't coming out as well as they used to. We can see what we call executive weaknesses, difficulty with higher order thinking, planning, problem solving, putting things together. We can see visual spatial changes, just kind of harder to see things in your mind's eye. And in some folks, when the severity of these cognitive concerns gets to a certain level, we call it dementia, which just means significant problems with memory, significant problems with other thinking skills, and it's giving you trouble in daily life. Very often, though, early on, what we see cognitively is that the cognitive changes tend to mirror or really reflect what a person experiences on the outside. So we talk about bradykinesia, slowed movements. We also often see bradyphrenia, slowed thinking speed. And that can obviously be very frustrating. We can see sleep issues, excessive sleepiness, insomnia or lack of sleep. We can see restless leg syndrome. We can see REM sleep disorders, acting out of dreams, thrashing in bed. And when we have problems with sleep and we're not getting a good charge on our battery, then we're going to have more trouble in daily life dealing with the physical, the motor symptoms, and a lot of the other stressors that come up. Apathy. This is something that's discussed in the literature as being unique from depression. Apathy has to do with decreased interest, decreased initiative, like lack of get up and go, or just kind of this indifference, this eh. Well, do you want to go see family? Eh, I don't know. Well, do you want to go to church? Eh, I don't know. Well, do you want to go to the Y? Eh. And what we've learned about apathy is that it's kind of unique to Parkinson's, in that even if Parkinson's patients don't have severe depression or severe cognitive changes, or even if the motor symptoms aren't as severe, we can still see a lot of the apathy. And I'll talk about a hypothesis behind that here in a minute. I throw on suicide because the research has shown us that with any type of a condition like Parkinson's disease, where a person is experiencing a lot of changes, you tend to compare life now to how it used to be. And I'm not able to do what I used to be able to do. I can't function the way I could function. And so it's normal for people to have some of those thoughts that, gosh, is it worth it? Okay? It's not unexpected to hear people say things like that. And so I put this on here not to say that individuals with Parkinson's disease are going to commit suicide. Okay? It's just to say that it's something that we want to keep on the radar. Okay? So hopefully I'm getting it home that we're not just talking about a movement disorder here. There are things that we can see. Okay, there are a lot of outward motor symptoms that we can see. But there are also a lot of things that we can't see. And those things, those internal things, are just as important. Just like Dr. Sriram said, there are things you have to ask about, and there are things you have to speak up about. And like Dr. Kobet said, if you don't speak up, the physician might not ask. Very often, because the motor symptoms are most easily observable, those are the primary focus of treatment. Here's a medication to help you with your tremor. The emotional symptoms, though, because they're not visible, they can be missed by the physician, they can be underreported by the patient, or not reported at all. But they are real, and they're just as important to address as any of the physical symptoms. We know in Parkinson's disease that there are changes in the body and there are changes in the brain. We know dopamine is involved. It's a neurotransmitter. It's important for smoothing out movements, among a lot of other things. Dopamine is also involved in reward centers in the brain. When you do an activity and it's pleasurable to you, dopamine helps tell that reward center in the brain, hey, this is good. This was good for us. Yeah, we like this. Do this some more. If the dopamine isn't there to kind of feed and fuel the reward center, then the reward center isn't going to give us that feedback that, hey, this is a good thing, keep doing it. And so if you think about the lack of dopamine not facilitating the reward center, that can give us some insight as to why this apathy can occur. You're not being told by your brain that something is pleasurable or enjoyable. This does not mean that you're crazy, okay? It's just saying that real changes are occurring in the brain that are causing you to feel a certain way. So what do you do? So this is a quote that I love. If you're going through hell, keep going. Right? And when I tell this to patients, I often also say, because it's not a place you want to settle down. Okay. As we've discussed earlier, there's no cure for Parkinson's disease. Once you've got it, you've got it. okay? You can't control that. Now it's time to focus on the things that you can control. So, first thing, and again, it varies from person to person, but if you notice that things are bothering you emotionally, acknowledge it, okay? It's not a sign of weakness. It could actually be happening. Nobody's going to judge you. Nobody's going to think you're crazy. We know that these things happen. Step two, again, like Dr. Kobet said, speak up. Let your doctors know what's going on. Let them know what's happening inside. Step three, ask about what you can do. Hey, do you have physical therapists? Or hey, do you have psychiatry? Or hey, do you have occupational therapy? See what's out there. And don't hesitate to speak up about the emotional concerns. Also, let your family and your friends and your support network know what's going on. And family, friends, and support network, don't hesitate to ask what's going on. Just asking about someone, asking someone if they're sad isn't going to make them sad. It's just going to make them tell you what's going on. If needed, consideration of participation in therapy or counseling could certainly be important. I will say there are some empirically supported treatments, treatments that we know work, like cognitive behavioral therapy, at addressing some of the emotional concerns that we can see in Parkinson's disease. CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, has well-researched protocols for depression, for anxiety, and for mental health issues in Parkinson's disease specifically. It's not laying on a couch and telling your analyst about your relationship with your mother, okay? We're talking about analyzing thoughts, understanding thoughts, how they lead to emotions and lead us to certain behaviors, and then where can we intervene to see some different patterns in our thinking and get different outcomes in daily life. Again, if needed, there are medications for different mental health concerns, including depression and anxiety, sleep issues, but also when we see cognitive changes. There are medications that can be beneficial. And very often a combination of both therapy and medications can be most useful when we're dealing with some of these mental health concerns. Exercise is very important. Has anybody heard of Big and Loud? Right? Yes, right. So it's kind of the opposite of how a person with Parkinson's feels, right? They teach you to get big and really do those movements and speak up, you know, use your voice, get out there. There are dance classes, yoga classes, all kinds of different things offered. And as a general rule, like Dr. Kobet had mentioned, exercise is important. What do your doctors tell you every time you go to see them? They say, get exercise, right? It doesn't change just because you have Parkinson's disease. You might not be able to exercise in the same way, but you can still exercise. I think part of the importance of having a multidisciplinary approach that's been referenced is that with Parkinson's disease, certain medications may work better than others. Okay, certain antidepressants might not be indicated when we have occurring Parkinson's disease. Certain medications for memory and other cognitive changes might not be indicated in Parkinson's disease, and other ones may be more useful. And so having more specialists involved, having a kind of a team approach, is probably going to be a more effective way to really hone in on the interventions that are going to be best for the individual. That was fast. Just some general statements here. Yes, there's more to Parkinson's than just the outward signs. It's not just a tremor disorder. If it were just a tremor disorder, they would call it a tremor disorder, but it's not. The team approach can often be very useful, okay, particularly when it comes to getting at the individual needs of the person. We need support from family, friends, other people in the environment. So speaking up, being your own advocate is very important. And if you notice that a family member with a condition isn't speaking up, do some advocating yourself. And take advantage of resources. We have things at the national level, but there are also support groups here in the community associated with medical facilities and non-medical facilities. Talk amongst yourselves. Talk to the people at your table. Talk to people in this room and see what kinds of resources that they have. This is a great opportunity to kind of come together and share some information. But don't hesitate to speak up. Okay. So now that the shrink is done, I'm going to turn you over to Dr. Boyce, and he'll talk about real science.
First and foremost, I would like to thank everyone for coming. This is an amazing turnout. And by the time I get ready to speak, I'm sure everyone is already tired and burnt out and no one's listening, but that's okay. I'm going to try to be short, sweet, and make it quite clear. So what is my topic today is the deep brain stimulation. You know, when you think of a surgeon, what do? We do surgery. So the job of everyone else is to make sure the patients are all prepared so that when it's time to see me, they are good candidates for surgery. So the deep brain stimulation has three portions. It's the electrode in the brain, and you can see the electrode here. There's an extension cable, and that attaches to a generator. And this is what is giving the electrical current to the brain. DBS has been approved for four major conditions: essential tremor, Parkinson's disease, primary dystonia, and obsessive compulsive disorder. The last two are humanitarian. The most common condition that we are using it for is the Parkinson's disease, even though essential tremor is probably more common than Parkinson's disease. We're going to just discuss Parkinson's disease today, but let's just discuss the surgery. There's two major ways of doing the surgery. The gold standard and more historical way of doing the deep brain stimulation is with a frame. So what you see here, this is the patient's head. There is a frame that is screwed onto the patient's head, and we use different components to help for our planning for the trajectory into the correct areas of the brain to help alleviate some of the motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. In Parkinson's disease, the primary area that we target is called the subthalamic nucleus. There are other areas, and we're going to discuss that in a little bit. And what we're doing is by putting in these electrodes, we're mapping out the waves, the neurons in the brain, and mapping out the area both as soon as we enter and when we start exiting the subthalamic nucleus of the brain. We also use x-rays to help ensure that we're in the correct area of the brain. I just went back to for here. So you can see here, there are two targets, one on either side of the head. One is a circle, one is a square. We lined them up, and when that electrode is in the bullseye of both, it helps confirm, besides the intraoperative testing, that we're in the correct place. In addition to that, there's also what we call a frameless system. So what I just described to you earlier is a frame-based system where the patient is awake. We're testing intraoperatively, having them testing their tremor while they're completely awake and alert. We are one of three centers in Michigan that has an intraoperative MRI. So for Parkinson's disease, we have the capability of doing this under general anesthesia. We prefer doing it awake, because that way we can get results immediately, but we tend to reserve the intraoperative MRI for patients that would not tolerate the awake procedure, patients that are very claustrophobic, if there's a huge language barrier, so it would be difficult communicating to do the intraoperative testing. We're able to do this procedure completely asleep. So what occurs here is the patient is asleep, we lock their head in the frame, and it's a very fancy system where we put grids in the head, which is what I was showing over here. Using the grids, we get an MRI. It allows us to do the planning to the targets in the brain, and primarily the subthalamic nucleus. And when I first started here, this intraoperative MRI was first installed. We are probably the only center in Michigan that has the higher powered MRI because it's a newer machine, so we can actually see the subthalamic nucleus on the MRI quite well. And then using these joysticks, we do our planning before implanting the electrode. So we do have that capability here. We are the only center on the west side of Michigan that has that capability. The two other centers that do have this capability are Henry Ford and University of Michigan. So, besides medical therapy, there are other surgical treatments for Parkinson's disease. And what this is discussing is that historically, there was a push for more ablative types of procedures where you go in and you burn an area of the brain. So you're causing a dysfunction in order to improve the motor symptoms. Unfortunately, doing ablative surgery, which is causing damage to the brain, you can't do both sides, and unfortunately, it is non-reversible. So a good example is everyone has heard of Michael J. Fox. Michael J. Fox has not had deep brain stimulation. He had this ablative surgery, and that could only be used to treat one side of the brain due to the complications of treating one side, treating both sides. So the beauty in the deep brain stimulation system is that most of the complications are reversible. Dr. Sriram, for example, would turn you on, do the programming. If you're having a side effect, he can program around that, get rid of the side effect. Those parameters helped, they're adjustable to help reduce any complications, and in addition to that, help maximize therapy. We just had another patient of ours who had, he actually does not have Parkinson's, he has essential tremor, and he had both a positional and an intentional tremor. And initially, with all the great programming, we took care of the positional tremor, but he noticed that he had a very task-specific tremor every time he went to take off his glasses. That became hard. We just saw him in clinic, and now he is a complete happy camper. This is the beauty with the deep brain stimulation. By undergoing this programming, we can help decrease some of the side effects and increase the therapy that is actually taking place. What are the targets that are being used? Well, I just told you the most common target that's being used is a subthalamic nucleus, and that is the historic target, and it has an influence on all of the motor symptoms with the exception of the postural instability. So it helps with the rigidity, helps with the bradykinesia, helps with the akinesia, helps with the tremor. I used to hand out a copy of a newspaper article from the Chicago Sun-Times in 2008 that was detailing how Parkinson's patients who underwent a deep brain stimulation implantation were having very serious fractures. And if you actually read the article, it's because these patients would get the deep brain stimulation system implanted and they would feel just about normal. And in my opinion, they started to do some crazy things like going up and trying to patch their roofs and stuff, and they were falling off ladders. So that was my warning to patients that, yes, we are taking care of some of the symptoms, but you're not cured. This is not the time to go up and start patching your roof, skydiving, et cetera. This is to increase the quality of life. The other areas, there's an area called the VIM of the thalamus. That is the primary target that we use in another disorder, as I mentioned, called essential tremor. This target, essentially, we will use if there's a predominance of tremor and there's other reasons not to implant it into that target. We seldom use this target for Parkinson's disease, but there have been times when I have used that target. But that is the most common target for essential tremor, where you just have that tremor. In addition, we also use another area of the brain called the globus pallidus. It is actually the globus pallidus interna. This is a target that we use in patients that have a condition called primary dystonia. However, we know now through all the literature that the globus pallidus is able to help with most of the symptoms that you have with Parkinson's disease, about equal to the subthalamic nucleus. It also has a benefit over the subthalamic nucleus in that it helps with any dystonic features in Parkinson's disease. And in addition to that, historically, we know that the subthalamic nucleus, if you have cognitive dysfunction or you have any psych issues such as depression, the subthalamic nucleus can worsen those symptoms. So in those patients, historically, we would not want to implant a deep brain stimulation, but now we will actually target the globus pallidus because we know this area will not cause that worsening. This is why we have this team approach. I want to know, before I implant a patient, is there any cognitive dysfunction? If there's any depression? If there's any mood disorders? Because if that's the case, that patient can still have a deep brain stimulation implanted, but in a different area of the brain, which should not worsen those symptoms. Last but not least, I discussed with you that we used the deep brain stimulation primarily in the subthalamic nucleus, and the only motor symptoms that we can't guarantee is going to be helped is the walking, what we call the postural instability. So I'd normally tell patients that 50% of the patients who have a deep brain stimulation implanted may have some improvement in their walking, but 50% may not. There is now another target called the pedunculopontine nucleus. It's still in experimental phase, but the deep brain stimulation is being implanted in those patients, and it has been showing some good results in helping with walking. So again, it's not finalized yet, but over the next couple of years, we're going to have some we'll have some results on that to see if this is providing a benefit in Parkinson's patients. This is a paper from 2012, and what it basically showed that the deep brain stimulation, specifically in the implantation of the deep brain stimulation in the subthalamic nucleus, was compared to best medical therapy, and actually, when you look at the combination of the DBS and best medical therapy, to just best medical therapy alone, those are the patients without the subthalamic nucleus, that the combination therapy produced better improvement in motor function as well as in the quality of life of patients. We also know, this is a different paper from 2000, actually this is the same paper, that the deep brain stimulation, we know this lessens the off period, that's where the patients feel like they're freezing. It also reduces the dyskinesias. People always ask, what are the dyskinesias? So we know Parkinson's patients have a resting tremor. They're at rest and they're doing this. But from the medications, one of the side effects of medication, especially if you're super therapeutic, you'll see patients now have dyskinesias, and it's sort of an abnormal movement that they can't control. That's a side effect from the medication. And we know that the deep brain stimulation reduces the dyskinesias that are present. As a matter of fact, when you're looking at this, that the subthalamic nucleus, which is the most common area that we implanted, there is the reduction in the dyskinesias is primarily due to the ability to reduce the sinemet that the patient is taking. Whereas with the globus pallidus, the stimulation patients experience reduction in dyskinesias without any levodopa dose reduction. So the target itself somehow is decreasing the dyskinesias that are present. In addition to that, deep brain stimulation may help in reducing some psych symptoms, particularly visual hallucinations, as well as impulse control abnormalities. Dr. Sriram mentioned this European trial, which was published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2013, and he already pointed out that there was a 26% improvement in the quality of life in those patients that had deep brain stimulation implanted in early Parkinson's disease. And this is important because historically, the neurosurgeons, we would not see patients unless they were middle or more so advanced stage Parkinson's disease. And we now know that we can get even better results in those patients that have early Parkinson's disease. And when you compare it, there was actually a 1% worsening in these early Parkinson's disease just with medical therapy rather than a 26% improvement with deep brain stimulation. 53% less motor disability with the deep brain stimulation. Improvement in activities of daily living, fewer levodopa-induced motor complications, and more time with good mobility without the dyskinesias. As a matter of fact, I mentioned to you earlier that one of the reasons why we use that secondary target, the globus pallidus, was because the subthalamic nucleus could cause worsening in the cognitive function and mood disorders in those patients where it's already present. And in this paper, in the early Parkinson's patients, they saw no evidence of cognitive decline with the implantation of the subthalamic nucleus. There was a small significant worsening in depression, and again, we already know this, as I said, due to the subthalamic nucleus. That's why in those patients, we would typically consider implanting in the globus pallidus. When you look at adverse risk, obviously, doing surgery, if you look at patients that were medically managed versus surgery, there's about a 10% higher risk of having adverse reaction. I'm sorry, I'm going backwards again. Of course, that surgery, there's a risk of bleeding. We're operating on older patients. But if you isolate the surgical complication, the frequency of non-surgical complications was actually much higher in the medical group. So if you isolate the surgical procedure itself, the risk of complications was actually higher within the medical group. Okay. I think one slide got skipped, but since I am the last person to speak, I just wanted to discuss, you know, sort of put together everything that we've been saying. You know, when I started here almost 3.5 years ago, Spectrum Health did not have a movement disorder team. We did not have a movement disorder program. I was the first one that came here, and it has basically exploded, and I'm expecting good things over the next 5 years as we continue to get bigger and better. Our goal is to be able to treat patients here without having them to go outside of state for this type of care. One of the issues with building a program here is that we do reach out for donations to help with certain costs. You know, one of the things that we just purchased was this $50,000 driving simulators for those patients with cognitive issues. We can actually test their driving capability to make sure that they're driving safely. These are the type of things that we would want to be able to do with the Parkinson's and movement disorder patients here as well. I put this up, there was a recent Spectrum Health Foundation gala just last Saturday, and over $800,000, about $800,000 was raised to help fund improvements in the dementia clinic here as well. So if there's anyone who's interested in any donating to help Spectrum, especially in regards to the movement disorder center, there's brochures that you could pick up at the end. I think that is going to be it, and we're going to be opening up to the question and answer portion of the program.